Don't worry about it.
You can, for sure.
Good morning. Please silence all electronic devices. The agenda for the school board meeting is published and available at least 1 week prior to the board meeting. Also, 1 week prior to the meeting, members of the public have the opportunity to correspond with board members, with those communications becoming part of the official record. Any member of the public who wishes to speak on an agenda item will have an opportunity to do so prior to final action being taken. Please fill out a speaking request card available in the lobby. During the public comment portion of this meeting, names will be called as they are received. Any member of the public wishing to speak on a non-agenda item on matters relevant to the school district will have the opportunity to speak at the end of the meeting. Please fill out a speaking request card available in the lobby and names will be called as they are received. Please note that for speakers to address the board on either agenda or non-agenda items, their speaker request form must be submitted prior to public comment on the meeting agenda items begin. We welcome members of the public to attend our meetings and we respect the public's right to speak to the board. We're really glad that you're here. I want to remind everyone that we have a civility and respect policy, so please address all comments to the board and remember that this is a professional meeting. We want to be fair and efficient. Our vision statement is all students achieve success in college, career, and life. And our thought for the day is Mrs. Armstrong.
Good morning. This is by an author unknown, but I think it's very important to remember this when you consider leadership. The most important key to successful leadership is your ability to direct and challenge the very best that is in those who you lead. Thank you.
Please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to announce that all board members are present. I'd like to ask for a moment of silence for the family of Louis Cosme, the plant manager at Ronnie B. Cox Elementary School. Thank you. I need a motion to approve the minutes of the regular meeting of March 19th, 2024 and the workshop of March 19th, 2024.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Hernandez, second by Mrs. Armstrong. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. We have no special presentations this morning. We do have an instructional materials hearing, public hearing on social studies. I am now going to open the public hearing on the instructional materials for social studies. Attorney Meeker.
Thank you. This is to announce the public comment portion of the public hearing on instructional materials, social studies. Notice of this hearing has been posted on the district website and publication in compliance with Florida statutes and publication of general circulation in Pasco County in compliance with Florida statutes. Any member of the public who wish to be heard on the instructional materials, in this case social studies, are asked to complete a green speaking request card that you can obtain from the board secretary or at the entrance to the boardroom. When your name is called, please approach the podium and state your name and address for the record. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to speak unless an extension is granted by the board chair. If you haven't yet filled out a card and you want to speak on this public hearing, please do so right now before we act. Thank you.
All right, I have one that's been submitted, Mrs. Rogers, Pat Rogers. Good morning.
Good morning, board superintendent and all your support staff. I looked at this and it looks really interesting, but because I don't have a password or anything, I couldn't read any of it. And all I got were the chapter headlines and bullet points. So I would love to, when you put something in this, like this in the school board minutes, that it would be available for you at least to peruse a couple of chapters out of the whatever the material is.
Don't we normally have that?
It is available. Yeah. It is available. Ms. Mitchell, do you want to speak to that just a minute?
I just may not have known how to get to it.
Yep.
I was gonna say, I think it was. Sure, I'm happy to speak to that. During this process, the logins for all of the materials that are up for adoption for, under recommendation, the logins and passwords are available on the public website. They can log in, and I'll be happy to show Ms. Rogers how to do that as we conclude.
Thank you. I was just going to say, I just pulled it up and then right there. Thank you. Thank you.
I believe we have a gentleman.
Okay. Outside. We'll wait 1 second. If you want to tell him to come in and he can finish filling it out at the end, that's great. If it's on,
is it for the public?
We're going to find out. That way we're not.
Well, welcome back from spring break, everyone. I hope you had a nice break. Yeah. Ready to finish strong, right?
Woohoo!
Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, it's not public hearing. Okay. All right. So, anybody else want to speak on the public hearing? Just want to make sure. Okay, great. There is no vote taken today, so I'm going to now close the instructional materials public hearing on social studies. That brings me to 5.1, adoption of off-agenda items. Superintendent Browning, are there any off-agenda items this morning?
No, ma'am, not today.
Okay. That brings us to public comment. 6.1, agenda items only. Attorney Meeker.
Thank you. This is the opportunity for the public to be heard on items appearing for action on the meeting agenda. Copies of the agenda are available at the entrance to the boardroom. To speak at this time, you must have submitted a green speaking request card located on the tables at the entrance to the boardroom. The form must indicate the specific item or items you wish to address. Speakers wishing to address general matters not on the agenda should complete the pink speaking request card and will have an opportunity to speak later in the meeting. Speakers who wish to speak on both types of topics will have their available time allocated amongst the topics and will have to save non-agenda comments for the appropriate segment of the agenda. If you have any materials you wish to share with the board, please provide them to the board secretary prior to speaking. Each speaker will have up to 3 minutes to address the board at a meeting. If you see the yellow light on the podium, please wrap up your comments to leave time for other speakers. Speakers will be called to come forward by the chairman. Prior to making your remarks, please state your name and address for the record. All speakers and comments are subject to the applicable school board bylaws and policies, including those requiring appropriate decorum and civility. All statements shall be directed to the presiding officer. No person may address or question board members individually. Staff members shall not be expected to answer questions from the audience unless called upon to do so by the board chairman or the superintendent. Any Let's Talk comments received will be made a part of the record.
I, too, just want to remind everyone that this is a professional meeting of the board. The board is having a meeting to discuss the business of the school board. We do ask that you do address all comments to the school board, and we also ask that you keep all side conversations down and bring them into the hallway. We want to be respectful of the speaker, and those can be distracting. We want to be fair and efficient, so please make sure you're ready to speak, and please make sure that you state your name and address for the record so we can take accurate minutes. We're really glad that you're here. First up, I have Mrs. Rogers again, Pat Rogers. She's speaking on 1.1.
Good morning again. Father God, I want to pray for our school board, our administrator, all his support staff, the teachers, and the students. We pray that they will have a wonderful week, that everything here will be done in order as you see it fit, and it will all be for the good of our students. In Jesus' name, amen.
I have Sherry Butler speaking on 1.1 as well. Good morning.
Good morning to each and every one of you. You are blessed. God has put you in a perfect position to do the gifts that he has given you. I am here to tell you that I am a prayer warrior. And I know the power of prayer. And being silent, you can't pray. The purpose of prayer is breaking the strongholds. We live in a world, there is a lot of hatred, a lot of murder, a lot of killing. Our schools are demonstrating that little because the prayers we pray are going nowhere. You got to pray, meaning business. You wouldn't put somebody up on front line in a warfare without no weapons. Prayer is a weapon to clean up the school. If you learn to pray on your knees before you get here and have an open prayer of unity, you would be surprised how quickly schools can change. I pray in the name of Jesus, Father God, that these men and women have taken this position with your gift. I pray that they will learn how to use the power of prayer so it will work for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Ms. Butler. Mark Pruitt? Oh. Good morning.
Good morning.
He's speaking on 10.9.
I thought I was going to end. But...
Nope, you're speaking on an agenda item.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I had a question about...
If you could just state your name and address for the record. It's okay.
Mark Pruitt, 4952 Butler National Drive.
Thank you.
Chapel. That's enough.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks for letting me come up. I was just looking through some of the notes that are published about the... This is about the trip to Harvard,
mm-hmm.
97,000. I'm just, reading through the purpose of this. Learning how to establish high expectations from instructional quality. I'm a little surprised we don't already know how to do that, but travelers will leave with a school improvement plan they can put into action right away. I'm just curious, is that something they're gonna come back with that you guys are gonna vote on? Or,
yes.
I guess what's the real measurable purpose of this trip, I guess is what I'm asking.
Okay. Superintendent, can someone please speak to this? Because I actually did have a question on it. Thank you, Mrs. Hilton.
Good morning. The school leaders who will attend the School Turnaround Leadership Institute, which actually is part of our required principal turnaround pipeline that we are required to create. We had a group of leaders who went last year. They do come back with not only a clearer, more defined school improvement plan to assist in their school improvement efforts. As you know, those mm-hmm. school improvement plans do come to you
yep.
for review, approval, et cetera. The opportunity that those leaders have to engage with peers and experts in school turnaround have led to improvements, clear evidence-based improvements in our schools this year. And so we do believe that it has provided quality, has also provided improvement for us, and again, continues to assist us in that requirement that we have to create that turnaround school leader pipeline.
Okay. And also, too, I had I just follow up on that. I had asked about the funds and where those funds were coming from because I wanted to make sure that they weren't, coming directly from the general fund because it was a lot of money. And so it's being funded by computer science grants that our district received. Some of the schools are being paid with funds that they received as part of their five-year STEM implementation program for being converted to a STEAM magnet school. So okay. That's not coming directly out of our general fund.
And also, it's Title I.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Title I.
Well, I guess my interest is just make sure there is some measurable output of this because that's a pretty big expenditure.
Yep.
All right, yep. That's all I have.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments.
Thank you.
Okay, that brings us to 6.2. United Schools Employees of Pasco, Mr. Peace, good morning.
Superintendent Browning, Attorney Meeker, Chair Harding, honorable board members and district staff, good morning. I hope you're all well. I have a couple of comments this morning. In light of receiving the board packet information on new job descriptions just before spring break, we requested that one of the job descriptions be pulled due to real concerns that this is ultimately not the best way to go. I'm speaking of the academic advisor position. We've been told that this position was created due to school counselors not being available. Upon further investigation, there were 17 vacancies across the district posted yesterday for school counselors. While we do understand your concern and your desire to fill every allocation, I'm not sure that that qualifies as a critical shortage area, nor do I think a watered-down job description is the answer. In fact, many unintended consequences are created just by the establishment of this job description. These two positions are not interchangeable. A certified school counselor must have a master's degree in guidance and counseling. There are specific things that they can do that they need this training for. An academic advisor only needs a bachelor's degree in education or some related field. We were told this was a fix due to school counselors being unavailable, but if counselors do try to hire on in Pasco, they may very well find themselves out of luck due to the allocation being filled with a lesser qualified person, since these new positions would be afforded all the amenities of the current contract. You couldn't not renew these people at the end of the year to hire a counselor because we have language to protect that. Would you just change the allocation back to school counselor at the beginning of the following year? While you have that managerial right, it isn't cool, and it certainly isn't how we want to treat our employees, is it? If lesser qualified people are being hired to do pretty much the same work of a school counselor, are you going to ask some folks to do more than they're qualified to do? Or will some of the burden of the job now be placed on other school counselors due to the academic requirements needed to perform such tasks? It appears that one of two things will happen. Two positions will perform the exact same work, which is problematic because one employee is not qualified to do so. Or they will not be doing the same work due to those needed academic qualifications, so someone else, other counselors, will have to pick up the slack for the advisors. It seems like there was a fix prepared, but it isn't really a fix when you start breaking things down. More problems are created than fixed under the current setup if the contract is being followed correctly. USEP simply cannot support watered-down job descriptions as a temporary means to get by. We are asking that you vote down or pull the academic advisor job description until we can sit down with senior staff and work out the concerns that we have. I just want to make the board aware that I have had conversation with Melissa Musselwhite and Mary Falk, and they have both agreed to sit down and discuss this, so I'm asking for this to be pulled for today. I don't think there's a rush to get this done. On another note, we hope everyone's spring break brought much needed rest and relaxation for the final push of the year. Before long, we'll be getting ready for end of year celebrations and graduations. So let's pull together and finish this year strong. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Peace.
Madam Chairman, if I may,
yep.
Now Mr. Peace has completed his remarks. I want the board and our public to be aware that this position does not replace a school counselor. I and this staff and this district understand the role that school counselors play, and they, as Mr. P says, they have certain things that they can only do because they have the certification for it. They are the school counselor. However, where we find ourselves is that, as Mr. Peace aptly stated, we find ourselves with a shortage of school counselors. So, and I'm going to say something, bring on rankles, some feathers.
Don't say it.
But I will tell you.
I can perhaps speak.
Let me finish, though, before I turn it over to you. It just appears that the union is more concerned about their contract than it is making sure that students get what they need to be successful. We have students in our schools that are not getting the academic advising that they need, which you don't have to be a school counselor to academically advise. So that this is like revenue neutral. We are not going to take a position of a school counselor. We could convert it to get an academic advisor. But certainly our desire is to have school counselors in our schools. They're the ones that serve our students best. I don't want any board member or any member of the public thinking that we're just going to start discarding our school counselors because we can find, I think the term was used, like a lesser position of an academic advisor. That is not the case. That is not the case, and I want our board to know that. If Dr. Iles has anything to add to that, I'd be more than happy to hear from it.
I just want to say, as a former counselor, I know how important that position is, and there are qualifications that counselors have that an academic advisor would not, specifically related to mental health, which is extremely important right now. Please know that the situation that we're in is that we do not have qualified individuals applying that have that background. And we do have the academic advisement that is needed. So we do advertise as a school counselor, and we do look for that individual first. Then we also look for individuals that are willing to pursue getting that master's degree in school counseling. But the responsibilities do have to look different when we add in an academic advisor. I will state that I will not, at the high school level, let more than half of their counseling staff be an academic advisor, and it is a new area we're looking at. It's an important role, and we value it. However, we do have to have personnel in place. We have schools where literally they had 3 counselor openings this year. And so it is something we're struggling with, and it's an attempt to assist the structures that are in place.
Thank you.
Since we're talking about, may I ask a question?
Yes.
All right. In looking at this academic advisor role, since it will not be doing the mental health part of it, do we see that if some of that duty of academic advising might be taken off the existing counselors, would that give them more time to do the mental health?
Yes, it would. I will say at this point, because it's a new venture that we're going into, that we're still working out what that's going to look like. But yes, there's going to have to be a new model, because you can't expect a counselor to continue doing what they're doing when you don't have another counselor that you've depended on before also completing those same roles. So it is going to look different, but it could be in the sense that sometimes counselors assist with testing, that perhaps that academic advisor helps with testing so that the other counselor can do the mental health piece. But we rely on those student support teams to help make some of those decisions as well, because they're the professionals within the buildings that can say, this is what I think will work. And so we don't want to come out and say, this is how it's gonna look, when each school is different. I have 2 schools right now that have a different position instead of academic advisor. It was really an attempt to get somebody else in there. And then in other cases, it's only 1 person. And then in many cases, we have all of our counselors there because they are vetted and veteran staff that's there. So it looks very different at each school, but you are correct, yes.
And that's the one thing that I wanted to add to what Dr. Isle just said. This is actually an attempt to have a clean job description for that purpose. What Dr. Isle explained is, when schools can't fill these counseling positions, they're converting that into something that gets close. So you'll see some of them converted to graduation enhancement, some of them converted to social worker. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to find something that's cleaner for them to convert to, that really focuses on the academic advisement and doesn't get tied up in some of those other job responsibilities that are associated with being graduation enhancement or associated with being a social worker. So this really is just trying to create a mechanism that's cleaning up current practice, because that's what schools are doing right now when they can't fill the counseling jobs, is they're converting them to something else that gets them close. So we're just trying to create something that will get them as close to the counseling as we can for the academic advisement piece, and then that'll let the certified school counselors take on those mental health aspects.
Madam Chair, if I may. So by the creation of this, do we feel like we're going to be getting a bigger pool to address the 17 or so vacancies, or is there a specific recruiting effort?
One, we will continue to look for school counselors. Correct. That is our preference. Mm-hmm. But this allows us to provide relief to the counselors that are there when mm-hmm. we cannot find someone that's qualified to go into that role. It does allow us to consider other people because obviously it's a bachelor's degree that's needed and not that master's degree in counseling.
And we're kind of in a catch-22 because in some of those schools where we've had shortages, the existing counselors have been taking on basically the caseload of the missing counselors, and USCP has expressed concern with us providing additional compensation to those people for doing that work. So we are still looking for a way to find a solution that doesn't overburden our staff and allows us to pay people for the work that they're doing.
What does happen at the end of the year then? We're still looking for counselors. Mr. Pease made a point about, you know, now that that person is in that position.
Contractually.
Contractually in that position, is there still opportunity to bring in a counselor?
So
could that person go to another school?
Kind of the protocol that we've set in place is you have to advertise for a counselor first. And so the academic advisor is not the first line of defense.
Right.
It's when you've tried and tried and tried to find a counselor and you can't find a counselor, but you need to provide those services for kids, that's when you move to something else, whether it be an academic advisor. I still believe that we talked about social workers being an equally acceptable option because they can provide some of those mental health, you know, services and advisement. So those are kind of the priority first, is try and get a counselor, and if you can't, then we can talk about a social worker, and if that doesn't work, then we can talk about academic advisor. So if we find ourselves in a position where we have filled all counseling or academic advising allocations and need to revisit, do we have too many academic advisors and now we have counseling applicants, I think we are more than willing to revisit how that would work. We just don't foresee that happening anytime in the near future because of the national counseling shortage.
Well, Madam Chairman, since Melissa Musselwhite is the department director requesting the description, maybe she can provide a little more clarification.
And the other thing that Mrs. Hester Nettles brought up is because we require them to advertise, the conversion typically doesn't take place until after the school year has started. So these people are on temporary service contracts that end. The academic advisors would be on temporary service contracts that end at the end of the year anyway. Because they don't start
the year
on
that way.
Correct.
That's a good point.
Okay. Yeah.
Hi, good morning.
Morning.
2 points of clarification to reinforce. We always continue to advertise the school counselor position, and then if after a duration that, you know, working with the assistant superintendents, we feel has been long enough that it's been vacant, and sometimes that's months, we will then advertise the school counselor continuously, and maybe, like we discussed, a social worker or a graduation enhancement teacher, but we don't pull down that ad until we find a qualified candidate, maybe under those two job descriptions. In addition to that, right now, some of those individuals have signed a condition of employment to earn the school counselor degree. And their condition of employment might end for 2024, which means if they didn't finish that condition of employment, they would no longer be eligible for that position. But some are through 2025 because you can't get a master's in school counseling in a short period of time. So there is very specific scenarios for each school that are occurring. And so working with the assistant superintendents and with human resources, we went, you know, line by line, the individuals in those positions, looking at their conditions of employment, what progress they've made towards earning those degrees. But like everyone has mentioned, they're living in various positions, and it's very hard in our system to get them the right communication and to really know who's serving in what roles, because when you look at a school as a whole and you now see they have 4 graduation enhancement teachers, but really 2 are serving in the role of a school counselor, but really acting as an academic advisor, it makes the storyline very messy. And so our hope is, of course, we want school counselors. But like Mr. P said, while we're advertising so many vacancies, that doesn't include the ones that we have filled with people serving in other roles. And so our attempt is really to get a better handle and be able to communicate correctly what role people are serving and also not having them live in job descriptions that they're not necessarily fulfilling.
Chair, if I may. Thank you. As the superintendent did say, this is about serving our students and that they get what they need as far as academic counseling as well as everything else. So I would like to ask if we can just be advised as we go along, the board kept up with the status of how it's going, and if we're able to fill in these 17 positions is a lot.
And I know we have a national shortage of counselors, but if you could keep us apprised of this.
Absolutely. And if the board approves the job description, I think it's a handful, like five individuals that will be moved into the academic advisor position proposed for next year, because they do have that condition of employment through 2025. So they're working towards that school counselor certification. So that's really what.
So then we would be thrilled to keep them.
Correct.
Correct. And when they would earn that certification, we would then convert that position back to school counselor. And then, like Dr. Isle said, we will be advertising for school counselors, and we have 17 ads out right now, and we will continue to have those ads running. But as we get closer to the start of the year, or even after the school year starts, we don't want a school to have five school counselors, but four of those be vacant, or three of those be vacant. And right now, we do have, some high schools that have three vacancies for school counselors going into next school year. So we're very worried about them.
Yeah.
And that's like some of our big schools, like Mitchell and Pasco High School. We really need some staff that can provide academic advising to make sure that those students get the right courses so that they can graduate ultimately. And so I believe we're doing a very thoughtful approach. We are trying our best to fill those positions with the people we want in those roles. But we also want to make sure we have staff that can help guide the decision making for those students, and that we can make sure we reach our goal for having them graduate.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your explanation. Any other questions? Okay. All right, that brings us to 6.3, board member committee reports. Mr. Hernandez asked that I start opposite. Are you okay with that, Mrs. Crumley?
Yeah, I'm fine. It was spring break. There was no committee.
Yeah.
I have no report.
Does anybody have committee reports?
No, there was no.
Okay, well, there's spring break, so no committee reports. That was easy.
See, how easy you are.
Superintendent Browning?
Nothing today.
Okay. Attorney Green?
Good morning.
Mr. Shibley?
Just the addendum to item 11.1 that has been uploaded into the packet.
Thank you. Mrs. Kuhn?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to invite Mike Goody, the Director of Construction Services, to come to the podium with some guests to tell you about the project in the beginning stages at Pasco High School to build a classroom wing and new cafeteria. A portion of the work taking place at Pasco High School in the coming years is funded by the Penny for Pasco sales tax, so I just wanted to point that out as we have on these projects, because we're very grateful for the support of our community in making these projects happen and be able to fund this very important work. Additionally, there is a meeting with staff today after school to talk about this project so that they understand what will be taking place, the timing and logistics, and then with the community this evening at 6 p.m. So I'd like to ask Mr. Goody to walk us through.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yes, as Mrs. Kuhn said, we are getting ready to start some work at Pasco High School. We're going to demolish their existing kitchen cafeteria building and build a new kitchen cafeteria building, two-story building with kitchen cafeteria on the bottom floor and additional classrooms on the second floor. During this construction, we will set up a temporary kitchen and dining area for the school, because it will take more than a summer to do this work. The idea is to, and along with that, another piece of this project is we're doing some minor renovations in the existing media center. Some painting, some new floors, some new lighting, kind of sprucing that space up a little bit. The schedule is we've actually started doing some preliminary work out there now. The lion's share of this work will start as soon as school is out here in a few months, and then it will complete in December of 25. And then we'll be out of there, and they'll have a new kitchen cafeteria classroom wing out there. I have a few guests this morning. Our construction management firm is Williams Company, and Dirk Keller is here with us. Our architectural firm is Harvard Jolly PBK, Steve Johnson, and Frank Sepsik are here. So I'm going to ask Frank to come up and run us through the presentation. And then we can answer any questions you have after he goes through that.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present the new design of Pasco High School. My name is Frank Sepsik, Vice President and Architect with Harvard Jolly PBK. It's always an honor and privilege for me personally to work on a school within the district. Being a product of Pasco County Schools, although I didn't go to Pasco, I went to Galt. every opportunity I have to get to work with the district is very exciting. We understand the importance of this project for not only the students and the staff, but for the alumni and the community at large. You know, our firm appreciates the district's understanding of how architecture positively affects the education and growth of the students. That's what makes our job fun and exciting. So let's, do I just advance this one? So this is a partial plan of the campus, and the highlighted building number two is where the new dining hall and classroom building would be positioned. It's approximately 42,000 square feet, consists of 13 classrooms, a patient care technology lab that's in the existing building that we're relocating here, as well as a kitchen, servery, and a dining hall. Some of the important aspects of this project that we wanted to do right away was really use this building as a way of connecting the campus. This campus has been growing throughout the years, and buildings have been positioned. So we looked at the connectivity not only to the administration building, but all the buildings to the north, and how we can bring that into the campus courtyard, which is a great courtyard. So doing so, we sort of pushed the building out to the west a little bit. So as you can see, there's a straight access from the administration building directly into the courtyard. Looked at different ways of and strategies of doing that. Once we get into the building a little bit, and actually to step back a little bit, so the whole building actually shifted to the west, and we were able to do that based on the real estate we had behind the building and really rethink the delivery and access to the back of house kitchen and by pulling the campus building number two to the west. This is the first floor of the building. The first floor of the building consists of about 25,000 square feet. To the north side in the dark yellow is the dining hall. The dining hall on the right side that has an angled wall is a story and a half space. We did so to bring natural light in and have it really an exciting, very architecturally significant space. To the south of that in the lighter yellow is the kitchen and all back of house. We worked with all the stakeholders in the district to ensure all the design standards were met through all those spaces. And then in the green to the right is the access of the teacher's dining. The teacher's dining has a direct access to the not only the exterior courtyard, but into the servery, and nicely positioned within that space. And then the final part of that building is to the south. In the cyan color is all the patient care technology spaces, which once again, we worked with the stakeholders to ensure all the spaces are met, and then an adjacent classroom that's to the left. That potentially has an opportunity of growing that program, if so in the future. If not, it would just be a classroom for the school's needs. The dining facility holds 650 seats interior and 300 plus on the exterior. And that plus can be that it's adjacent to the courtyard and however the staff utilizes that space. Jumping into the second floor, up the top right corner, you notice it says roof overhead, and that's because that's that one-story and a half dining facility. And the remainder of the 12 classrooms are up here along with teachers planning, restrooms. And we really looked at the efficiencies of this project as far as stacking service places and service and really locating that. So we look at, you know, really spending the money wisely within this project so we get their most bang for our buck. Once we look into three-dimensional images, this is a bird's eye view of looking down on that courtyard. You can see all the paving that's in that courtyard. A majority of it, I would probably say about 80% of it, is existing. Now, there was a lot of paving in there, so we're during the demolition of that space, we're going to reuse a lot of that to sort of complete the new design and have it tie in from new to existing. And you can see that the courtyard has that straight connection to the administration to the north. Here's a view looking from the building to the north, and you can see the expansive outdoor dining spaces and the really way of activating that existing courtyard with what's there. Like Mike said, it's a two-story classroom wing with the one-and-a-half-story dining hall that's to the right. This is another view looking back at that courtyard, and this is the classroom portion with the circulation going up to the second floor. And we started to mix into the existing architecture of the campus with the colonnades of the existing campuses and how to tie in this new building with the existing fabric of the campus. This is one of the last exterior shots I'll show, and this is coming out of the administration suite. So as you walk out of the administration suite, you can see you have a straight connection to the existing courtyard. You have a direct connect into the media center, as well as a two-story classroom space, and it's a pretty dynamic stairwell as you walk into the campus from administration. Once we go in the interior, this is the dining hall. And you have your four server units. Story and a Half has that sort of Starbucks-ish feel that is becoming popular. I mean, the furniture in there is placeholders for now. The only fixed piece part of the project is going to be the bar height seating that's along that exterior back wall, which gives nice views for students to look in and out of the plaza or really have a place to go in the study as they feel is necessary. And this is the patient care technology suite, which is at the southern end of that building. And we designed it in a way that's this long linear space, which has instructional spaces and beds all along the south wall, a collaborative space in the middle with the teaching wall to the right. So it really fits the needs of all the stakeholders in the project.
Well, looks better than most hospitals. It's really good.
Thank you, appreciate that. And then lastly, talk about a little bit with logistics of creating and working with the district and the school staff to really work on construction zones and ensure the safety of the students are brought to mind while construction is going on. That's it. Any questions?
Thank you. Anybody have any questions?
No, this is great.
Yep. Really good.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for all your hard work on that.
Yeah, it looks great.
Thank you.
Great job. You guys always do a great job.
Thank you. Mr. Goody, did you have anything else?
No, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
So in addition to the team here today, Mr. Goody and Mr. Gant and the construction teams and architect, I'd also like to thank lots of people who have been planning this. Our maintenance team and Mr. Fox, Stephanie Spicknall and FNS because of the temporary kitchen aspect of that. Chris Williams has been part of it, and Carrie Cadlub, the principal, has been a really important part of the planning of this and all the logistics, so I'd like to thank them as well.
What does a temporary kitchen entail? I'm sorry, I'm just very curious.
So it is basically going to allow for us to prepare all of the food that we normally do in a temporary. Right. It has the same types of equipment in a temporary facility.
Is it just like a
portable?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Thank you, Mrs. Hilton. Good morning.
Yes, good morning. I have a super quick update for you. I want to say a big thank you to the Career, Technical, and Adult Education Department who assisted with the facilitation of Education Day for Leadership Pasco on March 21st, as well as the many other departments and school leaders who ensured that Leadership Pasco participants learned all about our world-class education on that day. I also want to give you a quick Race to Read update. The total number of readers as of March 31st is 22,353. That's an increase of almost 600 since the end of February. So 600 new readers in March.
That's great.
Our running total, the total minutes logged just for March was 3.5 million. And our running total is over 23 million minutes. So not over, continuing to go. Now it's just like, let's see how we can best ourselves, right? And lastly, I just want to let you know that we won our bracket for round four, Magnet Mania, even over spring break. And we are on to the final round. Thank you so much for your support of this at that work.
You're welcome. That's awesome with the minutes, because I think there was a post yesterday that just said 15 million. So we've already surpassed that, guys.
March reading madness.
Awesome. Mr. Barker?
Nothing for me today. Okay. Thank you.
Mrs. Gant, do you have anything? Mrs. Poe? Okay. Mrs. Hetzler Reynolds? Dr. House? All right. Spring break. All right. We have no expulsion hearings this morning. That brings us to 8.1, approval of the consent agenda. Is there anything that anybody that would like to get pulled?
I just have a comment on 10.9, but I don't want to pull it.
Okay, do you want to make your comment?
Now?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sure. It's basically in response to our gentleman who came and spoke during public comment that it's a lot of travel money, and I do agree there. And I'm just wondering if perhaps we can get a follow-up to the travel. And I know we've done that in the past to travel. And just track along how that goes and our school improvement and hang on one second. how the turnaround process is going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As a result.
Yes, absolutely. Some of that comes to you naturally, but mm-hmm. we can certainly tie right. it to this travel, so it's a little yeah. bit more explicit.
That'd be great.
And also, just, you know, I didn't mention before, the school improvement grant that is paying for a good portion of this also has its own metrics and evaluation that we have to report back for the use of those funds, and we can also provide
share that
to you
with
as
us.
Well.
That would be great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And then my other question that I was going to pull was on the academic mm-hmm. advisor, but we've yeah. already had a lengthy discussion.
Yes.
Any
yes,
other?
That was good.
Okay. So I need a motion.
I make a motion that we approve the consent agenda and all attached addenda.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Mrs. Armstrong, second by Mrs. Crumley. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes. That brings us to 16.1, Financial Literacy Month. I believe there's a... Do you have it printed, Ms. Bowden? Or...
Oh, I did not this time.
Okay,
you
I'll
have
get
it printed, though.
I have it right here. You want me to read it? Okay. Proclamation recognizing Financial Literacy Month and Teach Children to Save Day. Whereas recognizing April 25th, 2024 as Teach Children to Save Day as part of the Financial Literacy Month is an effective way to highlight the importance of creating financially literate citizenry rooted in our K-12 curriculum and to shine a spotlight on the importance of economic and financial education, as well as supporting and celebrating Florida's economic, financial, and community partners, entrepreneurs, and school programs that prepare our future workforce and citizens. And whereas the District School Board of Pasco County, the Office of Leading and Learning, and the Office for Career, Technical, and Adult Education support the importance of economic and financial education to prepare students for college, career, and life. And whereas Pasco County is fortunate to have many wonderful community partners that support the importance of economic and financial literacy education by providing opportunities to connect with students and teachers to ensure a financially literate workforce. And whereas our community partners are vitally important to the prosperity and financial security of Pasco County, Florida, and the United States of America, and connect with over 10,000 students a year through curriculum supports and meaningful learning experiences. And whereas by working together with educational institutes such as the Pasco Hernando State College, the University of South Florida, the Gus A. Strabo Center for Free Enterprise, the Economic Education, EverFi, Florida Council for Economic Education, and the local financial institutes, we can begin to address the value of preparing students to plan for a financially successful future and to be productive and financially responsible citizens within Pasco County in the United States. Now, therefore, be proclaimed by the District School Board of Pasco County that April is observed as Financial Literacy Month and April 25th is Teach Children to Save Day in Pasco County Schools. I make a motion.
I'll second.
Okay. Motion by me, Megan Harding, second by Mrs. Bowden. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Okay, that brings us to 17.1, individual board member reports. Mrs. Crumley, are you ready?
I don't really have anything to add today.
It's okay.
Since it's spring break, just yeah. welcome back, and yeah. let's finish the year strong.
No worries. Mrs. Bowden?
Good morning.
Good morning.
It was a great day celebrating our staff that are remarkable at the Chasco Parade, so thank you to everyone who made that happen. A community member contacted me with a suggestion, so I wanted to share this. He suggested that we reach out to the Supervisor of Elections, Brian Corley, about having some of our juniors and seniors maybe work at the precincts on Election Day or early voting. They could get a flat rate of pay and also earn community service hours. He suggested they might also get the volunteer hours for the training as well. So it might be an opportunity for our students for civic engagement, and I said I would share this information and ask if maybe there's someone could look
That's
into
cool.
it. Okay, they're nodding, so thank you.
Yeah.
I also followed up on the concerns raised by some families regarding ABA therapy, specifically during instructional time. And I want them to know that we hear your concerns. I spoke with the staff and asked them to reconsider the stance of not allowing that particular type of therapy during instructional time. I've consistently been vocal about preserving instructional time. However, for students with behavior challenges, it can be helpful to have a therapist working with them so they can access the curriculum during instructional time. They can help redirect, the specialist can help redirect the student and attend to inappropriate behaviors and teach alternate behaviors while the teachers are teaching. The classroom environment is where some students struggle the most, and that is nearly impossible to simulate at home. It also helps with the classroom disruptions for the rest of the students in the class if our students with behavior needs are supported during instructional time. I'm not advocating for having private providers push into the classroom for every type of therapy. However, when the therapy is specifically to address behaviors and to help students stay engaged in the classroom, I think it should be taken into consideration. Each student and classroom situation is unique. There are numerous variables to be taken into consideration. We all want what is best in the best interest of the students. So I did speak to staff, and the PIP, which is Private Instructional Personnel Guidance, is going to be reviewed and refreshed for next year. So thank you to our team for listening to the concerns that were raised by parents. And I have one thing, it can tie in with what was discussed earlier with the counselors. So a shameless plug for if you're looking to hire, posted this information, I shared it with some of our staff, but we are having an education system expo and Teachers in the Making Career Connections event at the University of Tampa. It's April 12th from 5 to 7. I've already talked to HR and we are going to have a table there, but if you know of any principals or anybody else who would want to have a table there, if they contact me, I would say the sooner the better, by Monday, I can get you in contact with the right people to have a table. We are marketing it to outside of just the education department because we all know, but students often do not know that there are other opportunities in the district. You know, we have other jobs that we hire for in many different services. So we put on there nurses, psychologists, accountants. We have people in finance. So we've sent the invitation. The president of the Honor Society sent the invitation to the College of Business. She's reached out to all the different departments. My dean is sharing the information. So we're hoping for a good turnout of students. So if anyone is interested in having a table there, you can email me and I'll get you in touch with the right people.
Let us know how that goes.
Yeah, we did it last year and it was a little different, so I'm hoping it goes well because it's a Friday. Because trying to work around everybody's schedule and it's on Friday afternoon. So.
Awesome. Thank you. A question?
Yeah.
So on your previous topic in the classroom, is that going to be revisited at some point? Or
Yes, I talked to staff and they are going to revise that and work on it. Yeah, making it. They are working on revising that. Yeah. Yes, right. For next year.
We don't know the exact specifics.
The exact wording, but they are to allow some flexibility where needed, would be a fair way to say it.
Mrs. Armstrong?
Thank you.
Yes, just one thing, and as some of you may know, I always volunteer for the Chasco Parade, and I work with lining up the bands and other parts of it. And I just want to really shout out to the band director at Gulf High School, Bill Rutherford. He was so instrumental in opening up the school, opening a parking lot, opening up his band suite to really make it easy for the bands that participated. Really couldn't have done it without all his support. He always count on Gulf High School leading off that parade. Gulf Middle School right behind them. It's the tradition, and they've never ever let us down. So I was just so pleased with it being the beginning of spring break at the participation that we did have from the schools and the bands. Not only did we have the Gulf High School band and the cheerleaders and the football team and the Gulf Middle School and band and other student groups from Gulf Middle. We also had a River Ridge band along with some of their student groups. We also had the 5A high school band. Seven Springs Middle School Steel Drum always has their float, and it just keeps growing and getting better every year. I think it's probably one of the fan favorites along the route. Then also some of the schools stepped up and had floats, Fred Marchman Technical College. We had the district float with all the STARS staff honorees, which some of the board members rode on. That includes the Teacher of the Year. And I think we had some other departments that were out there with floats. So I just really wanted to send a thank you for all those people taking their time out of spring break to participate and really make the Chasco Parade what it is, and just to really show the community what we have to offer mm-hmm. in our schools.
Well, and to your point about Mr. Rutherford, he was nominated for Teacher of the Year this year.
Yes,
he's amazing.
He was for definitely mm-hmm. excellent
truly
reasons.
Amazing.
Our HR team was there recruiting too. I saw
them.
They are working and they are trying to fill the position.
Yes. So just really thank you.
And they had a tent.
Yes.
It was great.
Yeah. It was a great event, great parade, and I was so glad that we were part of it.
Me too. Awesome. Mr. Hernandez?
Yeah, thank you so much, Madam Chair. Well, welcome back from spring break. Great, right? We're very, very close, right? We're almost there. So thank you so much. And, not much to share, but other than looking forward to attending the construction community event today at Pasco County Schools, so that we can share the wonderful development in the kitchen and the cafeteria building. Looking forward to that tonight. So
awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you. That leaves to me. It's just like a circle. I too attended the Chasco Boat Parade Street Parade a few Saturdays ago. It was truly a beautiful day, and I too just want to echo the thoughts of my peers. So thank you for everyone who was involved. I also want to give a shout out to the early childhood group. I see, she was in the back there, Vicki Wolin, and her whole team. We got a survey back, and it was amazing. They truly are making a difference in our littlest learners' lives, and not just the littlest learners' lives, but their families' lives. So just want to give them a shout-out. I'm so grateful, and I know we're working hard on getting that expansion grant.
Yeah.
I'm so hopeful for it.
He's rolling his eyes.
It's so great. So I think majority of you guys know, but I do teach as an adjunct teacher instructor at St. Leo University, and one of my goals is to try to help recruit and keep our, new teachers in Pasco County schools. And so that kind of came into fruition before spring break when I had one of my former students reach out to me, Mrs. Ergler, who's at Bexley Elementary School. And she said, I want you to come see my students' invention creation that we did for a part of our unit, social studies unit. I said, okay. So I wanted to just, there's nothing better than seeing your former student following her dreams and having her very own third grade class. And if you guys know, third grade's near and dear to my heart because that's what I taught. But you want to know what's even better? Hearing from her students and why they love her and all the things that they love that they're teaching her. So, or that she's teaching them so that they love learning. So I want to thank Mrs. Ergler for inviting me to her students' Imagine Invent Showcase. Their inventions were amazing and their writing and creativity was wonderful. The writing about their invention, I was blown away for third grade. It was really awesome. So I can't wait to come back. I'm just really proud of all of them, so I wanted to share that. And then yesterday, I got the opportunity to talk to the Positive Coaching Alliance of Tampa Bay, their board, about our amazing students, staff, and teachers, and all the wonderful things that they're doing. I'm really grateful that they asked me to come to speak, because anytime we can brag on our school district and our teachers and students, I love that. If you're not aware, the Positive Coaching Alliance has partnered with Pasco County Schools for about 8 years, providing professional development opportunities and leadership training to all of our coaches, players, and parents across the county. Currently, we offer the Positive Coaching Alliance leadership training workshops to a cohort of 60-plus student athletes in all of our middle schools and high schools. And Trey Starkey was there yesterday. He serves on their board, and he was talking about the workshop that happened at Starkey K-8 with their middle school, and he was just blown away at first on how the teacher there, that's part of the Positive Coaching Alliance, kind of like kept those kiddos, wrangled and, learning and how engaged they were, but just the benefit from our partnership with them. So I thought that was really awesome. And then our coaches take a yearly professional development workshop geared towards various topics like developing positive team culture, tackling current issues in youth sports, or building positive relationships with our students and parents. And then over the last 8 years, numerous student athletes from Pasco County have been awarded the Positive Coaching Alliance TIC scholarship, which is worth thousands of dollars. And I actually have had the opportunity to go to their annual fundraiser, and a couple of our students have been acknowledged there. So it's really cool. So I just want to thank them for their partnership and for allowing me to come. And I, too, just wanted to echo the comments of Mrs. Bodwin. You got to speak first, but I did reach out to those families as well. And I spoke to staff, and they did mention that they're looking at that PIP. So I appreciate you following up on that as well, because I, too, believe the importance of them being allowed to help with the instructional during that instructional time. It's very, very important. All right, that links us to 17.2. Is there any other business to discuss?
No, ma'am, other than I just want to remind board members that we have a workshop immediately scheduled after this meeting to have a presentation by Food Nutrition and the early or after-school enrichment programs departments.
Thank you. And then Attorney Meeker, do you have anything? Okay, that brings us to